الله سبحانه وتعالى our creator has sent us into this temporary world for a very temporary and limited period. Every second is taking us nearer and nearer to the grave. Hazrat Ali karram Allah wajhahu says, irtahalat ad-dunya mudbiratan wa irtahalat al-akhiratu muqbilatan. This world is going away from us with its back turned towards us. And the Akhirah is coming from the front. The clock is ticking away. And every second is taking us nearer and nearer to the life hereafter, the Akhirah. ہو رہی ہے عمر مثل برف کم چپکے چپکے رفتہ رفتہ دم بدم. The life is decreasing just like the melting ice. हो रही है उम्र मिसले बर्फ कम. द लाइफ इज मेल्टिंग अवे, द लाइफ इज डिक्रीजिंग जस्ट लाइक द मेल्टिंग आइस. चुपके चुपके क्वाइटली क्वाइटली रफ्ता रफ्ता स्लोली स्लोली दम बदम सेकंड बाय सेकंड. The second that passes away can never be recovered. The second, the minute, the hour, the day, the week, the month, the year that has passed can never, never be recovered. So we have to utilize these years, these months, these weeks, these days, these hours, these minutes, these seconds before they are lost. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that out of the many favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is this favor, the favor of time, the favor of life, the favor of hours, the favor of moments, that is neglected the most. And hundreds, thousands and millions of people are daily making a loss. نعمتان مغبون فيهما كثير من الناس. There are two favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in which many, many people make loss. Because they do not utilize this favor. And by not utilizing this favor, they do not make these two favors profitable. As-sihhat wal-farag. The first ni'mat, the first blessing, the first bounty is health. And the second ni'mat, second favor, second bounty is time. Leisure. That is why in another hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that اغتنم خمسا قبل خمسين. Make use of five things before five. صحتك قبل سقمك وفراغك قبل شغلك. Make use of your leisure time before you become busy, and make use of your health before you become sick. Because a sick person is not able to strive in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a healthy person is able to. And a person who becomes very busy, a person who is surrounded by commitments, engagements, is not able to devote himself to the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as that person who is not surrounded by commitments and engagements. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was more merciful for the ummah than their mothers, is giving us a very, very important advice. Utilize your health before you become sick. Utilize your youth before you become old. Utilize your wealth before you become poor. Utilize your leisure before you become busy. And make the most out of your life before you depart from this world. Seconds are just passing, my friends. Moments are just passing away without we doing anything for our hereafter. There are many of us who are wasting our time. And when we say wasting our time, we are doing everything for this world, nothing for the hereafter. This is one category of people. They are striving to acquire all the benefits of this world, all the gains of this world. They are interested only in the material aspect of their lives. They are striving day and night. And when they assess their lives, they come to this conclusion that I manage my time in such a way that I do not waste a single moment. There are so many non-Muslims who manage their time more better than we manage our time. Allama Shibli Nu'mani rahimahullah ta'ala was once traveling with a professor, Professor Arnold. And it was a sea voyage, and suddenly the captain announced that very soon our ship is in danger and very soon it could be drowning. So Allama Shibli Nu'mani rahmatullahi alayhi says that I went rushing into the cabin where my companion Dr. Arnold was resting, and when I went into the cabin I saw him in a very relaxed mood studying a book. So I said, Dr. Arnold, are you not aware of the condition that we are in, the circumstances that we are in? Did you not hear the announcement of the captain? The captain said that in a few moments the ship may sink. So Dr. Arnold said, yes, I am aware of that, and that is why I am making the most out of the last moments that I have. I know that the ship is going to sink and there is no point in running around here and there. We've only got a few moments of this valuable gift of God. So I am trying to make the most out of these a few moments. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant all of us the tawfiq to value this great ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is one category of people who do not waste a single moment, but they are striving for dunya only, for materialistic gains only. So from the worldly perspective, they are making some gain. They have lost their akhirat for the worldly gain, but they are getting something. Then there is another category of people who are wasting their time in those futile activities which does not bring any benefit in the hereafter nor in this world. No benefit whatsoever. Watching football, talking about football, watching cricket, talking about cricket, for hours and hours, our minds are occupied by football. And the only thing that comes onto the tongues of the youth or even the so-called religious people in this day and age is that it is permissible. It is permissible. So if it is permissible, there is nothing wrong with it. But friends, if you go to a shop and if there is something worth £5 which the shopkeeper is selling for £5 million, and if you have got £5 million, you ask any mufti that is it permissible for me to buy this item worth £5 for £5 million if I am happy? The mufti will say it is permissible. Why don't you do that? That is also permissible. With permissibility, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given each and every human the intellect. to decide what is beneficial for him in this world and the hereafter.
If it is permissible, fine, it's permissible. But what are you getting out of your striving for football?
You are sitting on the television set for hours and hours. You are listening to the commentary for hours and hours. You come to the masjid, you are talking about football. You are in the masjid in the foyer, you are talking about football. You are outside the masjid, you are talking about football. What do you get out of it? What gain? What profit? What benefit do you see? This is my question. A benefit of a single penny. There is no benefit whatsoever. No benefit of this world, no benefit of the hereafter. No benefit to the ummah, no benefit to the community, no benefit to the family, no benefit to ourselves. There is no benefit whatsoever. So if it is permissible, should you be throwing away these precious moments of your life, which are much more valuable than £5 million, in an activity which is not beneficial at all? When are we going to realize that this is a cobweb created by Shaitan to lure us and to waste the very, very valuable moments of our lives which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had granted us to make friendship with Him? Where are we going to realize this? My young friends, it hurts to know that our young boys are wasting hours after hours behind football. And then let us take a step further. This is whilst accepting its permissibility. But why don't you put the whole scenario in front of a mufti and then ask him whether it is permissible or not? Put the whole scenario in front of the mufti, that when the football season begins, when the World Cup season begins, then the only thing that revolves in my mind 24 hours or majority part of my 24 hours is football. Why don't you tell the mufti that even when I am performing my salat, it is football in my mind? The mufti will answer the question that you put forward to him. Why don't you tell the mufti that during the football season, if I have to miss my jamaat, I am prepared to do that. I perform my salat at home. Why don't you tell the mufti that if the football match is on a Friday, coming for the Juma prayer is burdensome to me? Why don't you tell the mufti that when I am sitting in front of the imam, then every single second of that moment I am thinking about football? I am anxious that why is the imam taking so long? Every moment of my salat I am waiting for the salam. Even in qiyam I am thinking about salam. In ruku I am thinking about salam. As soon as the salam is made, without any dua, any sunnah, anything, I am out of the masjid and home, straight on the TV set. Why don't you tell the mufti all these things and then ask him whether it is permissible or not? I am not a mufti, it is not my job to give a fatwa. But please go to a mufti and put forward all these conditions and the circumstances that you are in, and then seek guidance. And after seeking guidance in this manner, thereafter follow the view of the mufti. Friends, think for a while. Think for a while. These worldly luxuries and worldly enjoyments are going to come to an end. مِنْ حُسْنِ إِسْلَامِ الْمَرْءِ تَرْكُهُ مَا لَا يَعْنِي. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam has said that if a person wishes to become a perfect Muslim, if a person wishes to become a very beautiful Muslim, a Muslim with lot of beauty, a Muslim who is looked at with lot of love by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he wishes to do that, then he needs to leave each and everything that does not benefit him in this world nor in the hereafter.
So anything that is permissible, but it does not benefit a person in this world nor in the hereafter, in order to become a Muslim loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are supposed to forsake that.
And a person will not be able to become a good Muslim, a Muslim who is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without forsaking those items which are permissible, totally permissible, but which are of no benefit in this world, no benefit in the hereafter. Then how can a person think of acquiring the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the nearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whilst engaging in those activities which preoccupy his mind to the state that even when he is salat, standing in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is thinking about those people who are fusaq, who are fujjar, who are not Muslims, who have no relationship whatsoever with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and standing in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time thinking about them. Think, friends, think. And convey this message to as many Muslim brothers and sisters as possible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a limited stay in this world. And the time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us, we cannot save that time. We cannot stop that time. It's not like ice. Ice, if you take it out of the freezer, it begins to melt. But if you do not want to use it, then if you want to save it from wasting, you can put it in the freezer. There is nothing to freeze our lives. There is nothing to freeze. This is an asset that needs to be utilized immediately. Hazrat Maulana Shah Abdul Ghani Phulpuri Rahmatullahi Alayhi says that I understood the value of life one day when I worked out in the afternoon during the month of June and July in intense heat, and a poor person was selling ice, selling lorries. In India, poor people, they have 200 rupees, so they would go to somebody who is selling ice, they would buy ice, a block of ice, two blocks of ice, a few blocks of ice for 200 rupees. Then he would make lorries out of the ice, he would crush the ice block and he would put some syrup on it and he would sell it. And before this ice block melts, because he doesn't have a freezer himself, so before this ice block melts, he will try to make a profit of 50 rupees, 100 rupees, so that he is able to feed his family. And the following day, he will go with that same 200 rupees and he will follow the same routine maybe. If he is unable to sell this ice, then not only will he not be able to feed his family, but he will lose the 200 rupees also, upon which depends his whole life. So it was very, very hot. And this lorry man was standing there in the intense heat at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and nobody was walking past because it was very, very hot. So Hazrat says that when he saw me, he started to cry and weep, and he said, have mercy upon me, please buy something. Buy something before this melts. So Hazrat said, I stood there, that anybody who was passing by, he was saying, please, please buy this before it melts. Hazrat said that when I saw that person whose eyes was melting away, that was his whole asset, and when I saw his pitiful condition, then I realized the value of my life. That our life is melting away. It is melting away. It is the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the barakah of Hazrat that today we are all sitting here between Asar and Maghrib, and we are spending these valuable moments of our life in remembering Allah, remembering His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are sitting in the most beloved places to Him, and we are trying to worry about the hereafter. This is the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. So many of our family members, so many of our friends, they are wasting their time outside. So So please, friends, this is the great ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not waste it. Do not waste it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in a hadith that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant entry into Jannah to the people of Jannah, when the people of Jannah will be granted entry into Jannah, that means these are the people who are good Muslims. These are the people whose good deeds outweigh the evil deeds. These are the people who are the beloved of Allah. These are the people who control their desires whilst in this world, and they gave every sacrifice in order to acquire the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Jannah, the lowest category of Jannah will be equivalent 10 times to this world. The lowest category of Jannah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam has said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in a hadith Qudsi, أَعَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ. I have prepared for my pious servants what no eye has seen. No eye has seen. The tree in Jannah, the building in Jannah. In a hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that a palace will be made of one pearl only. A whole pearl. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the size of that pearl will be from the earth up into the air, it will be 60 miles. Only one pearl will be a palace. When in the days of the Arabs, and we have seen this in India as well, that when people used to come on the horses or on camels during the times of the Arab, when the person reaches his destination, then the first thing he does is he throws the whip on the ground. So the whip is a very small item. And the whip is thrown at a place which is not valuable at all. It is not taken inside the home. It is thrown where he is going to tie his camel. It is thrown where he is going to tie his horse. So you can imagine the space that this whip will require. Very small space. And it is outside the house, not inside the house. And that place is very dirty because it is where the camels and the horses are tied. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَقَابُ قَوْسٍ فِي الْجَنَّةِ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا تَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ. This place where a person will throw his whip in Jannah will be more valuable than whatever this world contains. This place where a person will throw his whip, that will be more valuable than whatever this world contains. أَعَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنُ رَأَتْ إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ لَشَجَرَةً يَسِيرُ الرَّاكِبُ فِيهَا مِئَةَ سَنَةٍ فَلَا يَقْطَعُهَا. In Jannat, one tree will be so big that a horseman will ride his horse for 100 years in its shade. 100 years will come to an end, but the shade will not come to an end. أَعَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ. I have prepared for my pious servants what no eye has seen. No eye has seen. We have not seen anything in this world. We would not have seen anything in this world. وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِيَتْ. And we have never heard, which we had never heard of. And a person can imagine the impossible as well. If you ask somebody to imagine the best car, then he will imagine something that will never come into existence. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said that the favors of Jannah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith Qudsi, that I have prepared for my pious servants what no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has ever thought of. You would never have thought of anything that we will be granted in Jannah. Allama Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala has quoted a hadith that a person will wish to eat a particular type of fruit, orange, apple, whatever, and he will be lying on his couch and only the thought will come, and a tree will spring up immediately laid with the best of the fruits, and one particular branch will bow down before him where he is lying down, and he will pick a fruit from it and he will take a bite. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allama ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala quotes this hadith, that when he will take a bite from this fruit, then this one bite will contain 70 different tastes.
Allah.
And thereafter he will take another bite, the second bite will contain another different 70 tastes. And this will continue. Every time he takes a bite, 70 different tastes, 70 different tastes. Friends, we are sacrificing these bounties and these nemats, the everlasting nemats, for paltry benefits of this world. أعدت لعبادي الصالحين ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. Despite all these nemats, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant entry to these people into Jannah after going into Jannah, what regrets will they have? There will be no regret whatsoever. But they will still have one regret. The time that they spent in something that was permissible, but it was not benefiting in the hereafter. The moment that they had spent in those activities which were not sinful activities, permissible activities, but which did not bring them any reward in the hereafter, they will have these regrets forever and ever in Jannah. So let us make a firm resolution that inshallah from today we will value each and every second of our lives. Each and every second of our lives. Each and every second of our lives. Hazrat Shaykh al-Hadith Maulana Muhammad Zakariya Sahib Rahmatullahi Alayhi has quoted certain saints that they would just make a porridge for breakfast, for lunch, for supper, the same style of food, and just drink it very quickly. So certain people question them, their students, their associates, that why is it that you always drink porridge? You don't eat chapati, you don't eat anything else with it, no meat, nothing. Every time porridge, you get some milk and you crush chapati inside and then you just drink it. So these pious personalities said that what we did was that we timed our lunches and our suppers. We sat down with chapatis and with meat and we ate and we checked the time and it took us 20 minutes, for example. And then we made a porridge and we drank the porridge and it took us 10 minutes. So we minus those 10 minutes out of the 20 minutes and in the remaining 10 minutes we started reciting Subhanallah. Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. And we came to the conclusion that if we eat chapati with curry, then we will be making a loss of 70 Subhanallahs per every meal. So from the time we came to this conclusion, we have stopped eating chapati and curry. And we have resorted to only this porridge so that we do not make a loss of 70 Subhanallah. These are our pious predecessors, my friends. And these were those people who did not commit any sins. And I was mentioning the categories. First category are those people who are engrossed in those things which benefit them in this world. Second category, engrossed in those things which does not benefit them in this world nor in the hereafter. And then we have a third category which many of us fall into, that we waste our time in those activities which bring the wrath and anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We waste our time watching films on television. We waste our time listening to music. We waste our time in adultery, fornication. We waste our time in consuming alcohol, drugs. We waste our time in backbiting. We waste our time in slandering. Each and every item is bringing the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should be even more careful in making sure that whenever we get the opportunity to do something that will bring us reward in the hereafter, that will bring us the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should make sure that we don't waste it. Let us make a firm resolution, my friends. Firm resolution. then we will not waste this valuable item that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us. And because this life is very, very valuable, that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, لَا تَزُولُ قَدَمَا إِبْنِ آدَمَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حَتَّى يُسْأَلَ عَنْ خَمْسِ. We will not be able to move from our places until we are asked 5 questions. The first question is, أَنْ عُمْرِهِ فِي مَا فَنَا. Give account of your life. From the time you had become matured, from the time you had become baligh until you breathe in your last, give me account of each other. وَكُلَّ إِنسَانٍ أَلْزَمْنَاهُ طَائِرَهُ فِي عُنُقِهِ وَنُخْرِجُ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كِتَابًا يَلْقَاهُ مَنْشُورًا. And the book of deed will be placed in front of us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, اِقْرَى كِتَابَكَ. Read your own life. Read your biography. Each and everything has been written in there. What you said, when you said, what was your inner motive, what were your intentions, what were you thinking inside, what were you saying, what were you doing, what were your circumstances, each and everything has been recorded. مَا يَلْفِزُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. When a person utters a single word, immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created 2 angels who remain with each and every human all the time, they will immediately note it down. وإن عليكم لحافظين كراما كاتبين يعلمون ما تفعلون. So when this person will open his book of deed, when he will begin to read, from the time he had become baligh, he will get all the flashbacks as he begins to read, that yes, I did this, I did this, yes, I did this. Yes, I was involved in this crime as well. I was involved in this crime as well. He will say, مَا لِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا. Ajeeb. It's a great wonder. This book has preserved each and every activity of mine. Each and every activity. Dr. Abdullahi Arifi, rahimahullah ta'ala, the Khalifa of Hazrat Hakim ibn Umar Thanvi Allahu Marqadahu used to say that our book of deeds are so filthy with evil a'mal and evil deeds that on the day of Qiyamah, when our book of deeds will be opened in front of us and when we will see doom and destruction, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to give us choice that look, you are doomed to the fire of hell. You are doomed to the fire of hell. If you want to safeguard yourself from the fire of hell, you have only one choice. Let your wife see your book of deeds. If you permit your wife to see your book of deeds, then I will let you go in Jannah. Or let your father see your book of deeds. Let your children see your book of deeds. Let your students see your book of deeds. Let your teacher see your book of deeds. Dr. Abdullah Arifi rahmatullahi alayhi says that our books of deeds are so filthy that at that time we would prefer to go to the fire of hell over anybody else looking at the book of deeds. Friends, when we are committing crime, when we are committing sins in the darknesses of the night, don't think nobody is watching us. When we are committing crime behind locked doors, don't think nobody is watching us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching us all the time. يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِ الصُّدُورِ. So let us make a firm resolution. إِرْتَحَلَتِ الدُّنْيَا مُدْبِرَةً. This world is going away. And the hereafter is coming. إِرْتَحَلَتِ الدُّنْيَا مُدْبِرَةً وَارْتَحَلَتِ الْآخِرَةُ مُقْبِلَةً. يَا سَاكِنَ الْقَبْسِرِ الْمُعَلَّى سَتُدْفَنُ عَنْ قَرِيبٍ فِي التُّرَابِ لَهُ مَلَكٌ يُنَادِي كُلَّ يَوْمٍ لِدُو لِلْمَوْتِ وَبْنُو لِلْخَرَابِ. يَا سَاكِنَ الْقَصْرِ الْمُعَلَّى. Oh, the one who is spending his life in high mansions. يَا سَاكِنَ الْقَصْرِ الْمُعَلَّى. Oh, the dweller of the high mansions. Don't think he will live in these mansions forever and ever. سَتُدْفَنُ عَنْ قَرِيبٍ فِي التُّرَابِ. You will be buried very soon in this very grave. Every day, an angel is making an announcement. لِدُو لِلْمَوْتِ. لِدُولِ الْمَوْتِ. When you give birth to children, give birth to them for death. Because sooner or later they will have to depart from this world. And when you construct buildings, construct them for destruction. Because the time is going to come when destruction will fall this building. In a recent visit to Turkey, when I was passing by the tombs of the great sultans of the Ottoman Empire, Sultan Muhammad Fateh, Sultan Ahmed, Sultan Bayezid, Sultan Suleiman, I thought to myself, كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. These verses were echoing in my mind when I was looking at their tombs. Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent, Sultan Muhammad Fateh, who conquered the invincible Constantinople, which nobody could conquer. These great sultans. So these verses of the Quran were echoing in my mind. كل من عليها فان. Anybody who is on this earth is going to come, his life is going to come to an end. He will definitely perish. ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will live alive, remain alive. كل شيء هالك إلا وجهك. كل شيء هالك. Everything will perish except the countenance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the couplets of Khaja Sahib rang into my ears. Mile khak mein ahle shaan kaise kaise, maki ho gaye la makan kaise kaise. Mile khak mein ahle shaan kaise kaise, the people were of with great grandeur, the people with greatness and grandeur, they have become a patch of this earth. Mile khak mein ahle shaan kaise kaise, مَكِي ہو گئے لا مَكَا کیسے کیسے. Those with mansions have become homeless. They have no homes. مَكِي ہو گئے لا مَكَا کیسے کیسے, ہوئے نامور بے نشان کیسے کیسے. The famous ones have become unknown. Those with great names and fame, nobody knows them today. Who knows Sultan Muhammad Fateh other than the historians? Who knows Sultan Ahmed? Who knows Sultan Bayezid? ہوئے نامور بے نشان کیسے کیسے, زمین کھا گئی آسمان کیسے کیسے. The earth has devoured the very great people, the magnificent people. So friends, let us value these valuable moments of life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us. Because this worldly life is going away. ارتحلت الدنيا مدبرة وارتحلت الآخرة مقبلة ولكل واحدة منهما بلون. حضرت علی رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ says that for both of these are sons. Some people are the sons of the hereafter and some people are the sons of this world. The sons of this world exert every effort to acquire the pleasures of this world. And the sons of the hereafter, they sacrifice everything to acquire the everlasting happiness of the hereafter. حضرت علی رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ says فَكُونُوا مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَكُونُوا مِنْ أَبْنَاءِ الدُّنْيَا. Become from the sons of the hereafter. Do not become from the sons of this world. Be from the sons of the hereafter. Strive for the hereafter. Give whatever sacrifice you need to acquire the hereafter. And do not sacrifice the hereafter for the paltry benefits of this world. فَإِنَّ الْيَوْمَ عَمَلٌ وَلَا حِسَابٌ وَغَدًا حِسَابٌ وَلَا عَمَلٌ. Today, there is no hisab. There is no reckoning. Today, there is no hisab. There is no reckoning. You have the opportunity to do as much good amal as you wish. وَغَدًا حِسَابٌ وَلَا عَمَلٌ. But in the life hereafter, there will be no opportunity for amal. No opportunity for amal. In the life hereafter, there will be nothing but reckoning. That is why Hazrat Umar Farooq رضي الله تعالى عنه used to say, حاسبوا قبل أن تحاسبوا. Assess yourself before you are assessed in the hereafter. Reckon yourself in this very world. Daily reckon yourself before going to sleep. Check what you have done during the 24 hours. After every salat, check what you have done between the two salat. After performing every amal, check your intention. Check your amal. Was it in accordance to the to the way shown by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Was your intention correct? Were you sincere in your intention? حاسبوا قبل أن تحاسبوا وزنوا قبل أن تزنوا. Weigh your deeds before they are weighed on the day of Qiyamah. وَتَأَهَّبُوا لِلْعَرْضِ الْأَكْبَرِ. And prepare yourself for that great court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So friend, let us make a firm resolution that inshallah we will not waste a single moment. Before doing anything, ask yourself, is what I am going to do permissible or not permissible? If the answer is not permissible, then you must stay away from it immediately. If the answer is not permissible, don't go near it. If the answer is permissible, then ask a second question. Is it beneficial for me or not? If it is not beneficial, stay away from it. If it is beneficial, then ask a third question. Is it beneficial for me only in this world? Or is it beneficial for me in the hereafter too? If it is beneficial only in this world, then keep away from it. If it is beneficial in both worlds, then carry out that activity. On every step you take, if you will continue with this monitoring, then inshallah time will come when without any effort on your part, these questions will flash quickly and you will be able to take the decision. Yes, I want to do this, I don't want to do this, I want to do this, I don't want to do this. It will become a habit for you. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam has mentioned so many virtues of the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which are very, very easy. The commentators of the Quran have mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not used the word do this in abundance for any ibadah except dhikr. Allah did not say perform salat in abundance. Allah did not say do this in abundance. Allah said, Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. Remember me in abundance. Remember me. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use the word abundance only for dhikr? The commentators of Quran have given many reasons. One reason is that the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so easy that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was expecting abundance from us, it was not very hard for us. It is very easy. It's like breathing. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, At-tuhuru shakrul iman walhamdulillahi tamla'ul mizan. You say Alhamdulillah once, the reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you will be so much that saying Alhamdulillah once, its reward will fill the whole scale. Alhamdulillah only once. وَسُبْحَانَ وَالْحَمْدُلِلَّهِ تَمْلَآنِ مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And if somebody says سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ, only سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him so much reward that this reward will fill the whole gap between the earth and the sky. كَلِمَتَانِ حَبِيبَتَانِ إِلَى الرَّحْمَنِ. There are two sentences, very small sentences, which are very, very beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they are beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the person who will utter them will also become beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So immediately the thought will come in our mind that if by uttering these two sentences I will become beloved in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they must be very, very difficult. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى lisan. They are very, very light on the tongue. Don't worry. They will make you beloved in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they are not heavy on the tongue, they are very, very light on the tongue. So when this person hears that they are very, very light on the tongue, then this question will arise in his mind that if they are very light on the tongue, then the reward will be very light in the mizan also, in the scale also. There won't be much reward. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Thaqilatana fil mizan. They will be very weighty in the mizan, in the scale. So two sentences, very beloved to Allah, the one who recites will become beloved to Allah, very easy to utter, but the reward will be so much that it will fill the whole of mizan. And what are these words? Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. Friends, what does it take? Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyi al-azim. Hazrat Abu Musa al-Ashari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says that I was reciting Subhanallah, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyi al-azim.
لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard me and he said, Oh Abu Musa, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم كنز من كنوز الجنة. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. This wazifa is a treasure from the treasures of Jannah.
Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after returning from the night of Mi'raj, he said to the Sahaba Ikram Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in that I met my great grandfather Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. And Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam has conveyed a message to all of you. The first message is that convey my salam to the Ummah alayhi salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Imagine my friend, the value of this Ummah in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the Prophet Ibrahim is remembering us and asking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to convey his salam to us. And thereafter he said that convey my message to your ummah. Tell them that Jannat is a barren land. There is nothing in it. So I have a location, Hazrat has a location, we all have a location in Jannah, it is barren. If you want to grow trees in this Jannah, in your location, then read the third kalima, Subhanallah walhamdulillah wa la ilaha illallah wallahu akbar. Once you recite the third kalima, Allah will grow one tree for you. You recite it twice, Allah will grow a second tree for you. You recite it thrice, Allah will grow a third tree for you. It is so easy. So easy, my friends. So let us utilize our time. Let us not waste our time. Before I conclude, let me just point out to you one trick of shaitan, one deceit of shaitan. One of the greatest tricks of shaitan and deceit of shaitan is that he will only expose to us the good sides of our lives. He will never let us contemplate on our lives and he will never let us see the bad side of our lives. For example, we have come for the Asr Salah. We have come for the Asr Salah. It takes us 10 minutes to walk from home to the masjid. After Maghrib, we will return home again. It will take us 10 minutes. 10 minutes from home to the masjid, we were throwing evil glance. We were looking at this non-mahram lady, we were looking at that non-mahram lady. We committed so many sins before coming here. 3, 4, 5 of us were walking together for 10 minutes. We were talking about this person and we were talking about that person, slandering, backbiting. So filthy. Then we came into the masjid before Salat, we were standing outside, looking at people and despising them, thinking evil about people, having suspicious thoughts about people, all major sins. And then we come into the masjid, we spend 10 minutes in the masjid performing Salat, 15 minutes in the masjid. We go out again, we spend a good half an hour in disobedience to Allah outside. And we spend another 10 minutes disobedience to Allah whilst going to home. So sins over sins. But when we reach home, the only thing that we could see is the Salat. That Alhamdulillah, I have performed my Salat today. And it is for this reason, we do not strive for the life hereafter. What we need to do is process. That is why our Mashayikh say, each person should do muhasabah in nafs on a daily basis. Daily basis. Each person, even the mashayikh, after reaching the status of mashayikh, they continue to do muhasabah nafs until they depart from this world.
Allah.
Every day we should sit down and we should look at the take-in. The shopkeeper looks at the take-in that today this is my income, this is how much I have made today. Every day he assesses the income. Similarly, we also need to assess our income and our loss. How many sins have I committed today and how many evils have I committed today? When we will check daily our lives, my friends, and when we will assess our amal, then we will benefit greatly. The first benefit that will come is that we will begin to worry about our life hereafter. Because if you make an assessment today after Maghrib Salah, you will realize that from yesterday Maghrib until today Maghrib, 80-90% of our amal were not in conformity with the Sharia. Not in conformity with the Sharia. They were. If we check the good amal that we have performed, and if we check our intentions, we will find that Riya was there. So these amal are not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the fikr of the hereafter will increase. And the pride will go away. Because we will realize our true self. We will be able to see the true picture of our lives. And daily by doing muhasabah, if we do anything good, if we find anything good in our life, we will say,
Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, oh Allah, this is only through your grace. You have been kind to me for granting me the tawfiq to do this good. So when we are grateful to Allah, Allah will increase this favor and He will give us more tawfiq. And whenever we will see something evil, we will say, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I make a firm resolution that this will not happen tomorrow. I make a firm resolution this will not happen tomorrow. So every day tawbah will be taking place. So our accounts will become clean and clean. So there are many benefits for this muhasaba. And I urge all of you again to abstain from engaging in activities that bring no benefit whatsoever in this world or in the hereafter. Especially the football season is beginning. Don't waste your life. Don't waste the valuable hours that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted you. You will be answerable in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now football is becoming a religion. Even the non-Muslims are saying that football is a religion. It is an ideology. And the mass media is attracting each and every person towards this. And this football is taking each and every person in its web, and it is very, very difficult for somebody who becomes addicted to come out of this. So keep away from it. Connect yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Disconnect yourself from each and everything that may disconnect you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم احفظنا من كل بلاء الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من زوال نعمتك وتحول عافيتك وفجاءة نعمتك وجميع سخطك. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من جهل البلاء ودرك الشقاء وسوء القضاء وشماتة الأعداء. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى. اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك منه نبيك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه نبيك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. رب اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين. وصلى الله على خير الخلق.
Mm-hmm.